Hi. Come in.
Welcome to my apartment.
Mark Crowley was very helpful with sharing memories that he had about the process of writing the play. A lot of personal stories about who these guys were based on.
And Mark wrote me probably the most beautiful email about the history of Bernard and a boy he knew that he was enamored by. It was mind-blowing for me.
They're based on people he knew, and they are really his group of friends. And they came to life in this, you know, feat of imagination, this huge creative risk.
I don't know that I knew what the hell I was doing, to tell you the truth. I mean, I knew I was writing a play about gay life. This is sort of a New York gallery, as you see. It's only wide enough for one person to look at the pictures at one time. But these are all my friends.
The play in 1968 was a huge success. It was really revelatory and unprecedented. Nobody had ever seen anything like it at the time.
The boys in the band originally premiered off-Broadway April 14th. It was Easter Sunday, as a matter of fact, and the joke was, I hope it doesn't lay an egg. The revival of the play was 2018, 50 years later. This is the photograph that was used to publicize the play on Broadway, and it is obviously mocking up the original. Here we are, the cast and me. I wanted to acknowledge the bravery of those guys that took on those parts, even against the advice of their agents.
This was the first time we saw people in this situation, the first time we saw gay people represented on stage. It was at a time when being gay wasn't legal, it wasn't okay, it wasn't accepted.
There was a tremendous undercurrent of fear about what this could do to them in their careers.
It would have been career suicide to have come out and not even acknowledge personally that they were gay, but because some of them weren't. The actors all in this version are open and out, but in the original, six were played by gay actors and three were played by straight actors. All of them, though, had everything on the line. You know, the gay community had been verboten, so nobody ever really talked about it unless you were in your own private surroundings. And there's Billy Friedkin and me on the set of the boys in the band up there. But I had to be honest with you, you know, I was either so dumb or so young, I didn't even feel like I was taking any risks. This original set design by Peter Harvey.
I wrote to Mart, and I have this trove of emails from him now that are so well written and such good reads about all these movies that made an effect on him, and I saw this and this country, and I mean, because he is another one, like Michael, he was always jet-setting around or whatever.
This cigarette box, it was a gift from the cast and crew. They bought it in Tiffany's, but Tiffany's wouldn't engrave it because it has a line from the play, which is thank you and fuck you.
You know what you are, Michael. You're a real person.
Thank you and fuck you.
This is who Donald was based on, my friend Douglas Murray, and the play is dedicated to Doug and to Howard. They couldn't stand each other. Okay, that's Howard. That picture was taken by Jerome Robbins.
Mart has been a great resource, but he's also said, you know, do what you want. You know, I think he knows that after 50 years, the script is really, really sturdy and it's gonna survive, you know, this interpretation, and he's been completely generous.
This is my goddaughter, and she's holding up the photograph that is a gift in the play.
This play has gone through so many different iterations in terms of how it's been perceived by society. It was loved and adored because it was the first time gay men were being portrayed like this on stage, and then it was sort of reviled because people thought it was regressive. And then I think the nice thing about 50 years later is that we're able to revisit in a way where we could say, oh, this is a part of our history.
I like this picture very much. There's Joe on one end and Ryan on the other end and me here.
The fact that all actors involved in this are openly gay men. It was a great way to show how far we'd come, the fact that now everyone can be open with themselves.
There were people who said, I remember this, thank you for telling our story. And then there were young people who said, you're telling my story.
One person was like sobbing, crying, and he said, I'm just so proud. I'm so proud to be an out gay man.
Ones my age that were saying, oh, we're not like that anymore. And then the youngest ones saying, well, we're still just like that.
The jokes and the shade and the humor, there's something about it that's so familiar to me and my generation, and it speaks to being a part of history and some sort of spirit out there in the world that won't ever change.
As a young person, gay, straight, whatever, there are certain historical things that have gone on, and you can be a better version of who you are by knowing what came before.
There is a phenomenon as a 52-year-old gay man where you don't really know how to grow old gracefully. Mart is, for me, an example of what is possible.
Here's the Tony Award that we all won. Well, I was totally surprised. Nobody believes that, but I was. I mean, the fact that I didn't even have a speech prepared. I mean, I knew who I had to thank. I had a list. I got out a paper that had a list of people that I had to thank, but then my eyes teared up and I couldn't even read that. You know, I sold the play and that bill of goods by couching it as a comedy, and the laughs lightened it up and made it permissible for the audience to participate. So I hope that they not only laugh at the jokes still, but I hope that they take the serious content that's buried underneath that to heart. This telegram, which was from my psychiatrist, sent it to me on opening night. Dear Mart, no one could be more pleased nor proud of you than I. So we'd come through a lot together, and I guess he was thrilled with his work.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.